real quick, I promise you. Now, if ye be ready, that at what time you hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, the dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the image which I have made. But if ye worship not, ye shall be cast in the same hour into the midst of a burning, fiery furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand. Verse 18, but if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. I'd like to quickly speak to you from a subject. I have a subtopic too. The subject is dealing with difficult decisions. Right. Subtopic, how to not die in a fire. Mm. The truth of the matter is, no matter who you are, no matter where you've been, no matter what your education is, no matter how much money you have, there will come a point in your life where you deal with some difficult things. I don't care if you're a baby or if you're a grown up, there will be stuff in your life that sometimes it feels like you just can't handle. And so when I begin to look up fire, and I don't understand all the chemical and the technical terms, but what I do know is that fire burns, and that sometimes it feels like the pressures of life will cause us to be burning even on the inside. I remember a young man, he was about 8 years old when I was about 16, and it flashed across the news, and it says Khalil was killed in a house fire. And everybody was upset, everybody was hurting on the inside, because nobody could understand how this young boy, how God could allow this young boy to die in a fire. Why wasn't there anybody there to save him? Why wasn't anybody there to keep him? And I don't know who I'm talking to here this morning, but some of you have felt like that in your life. God, I pray to you. God, I really needed help at a point, and I gave you all my worship, I gave you all my praise, I cried out to you, but it still seemed like I was dying in a fire. And so, this morning I just wanted to talk to you about some things, because young people deal with difficult decisions. One of the biggest decisions that we deal with, even coming to college, is a lot of times we don't know who we are. That's why it's people that sit to the left and the right of you, they didn't act like that in high school. They didn't act like that back at home. But when they come to board meetings, all of a sudden, they have an identity crisis. And you know that really ain't them. You know they're putting on a front, but we really don't know who we are. Because if we knew who we were, we wouldn't do what we do.
That's right.
You say amen if you can. So in this story, Nebuchadnezzar, the king, the person in charge, decides to make an image and a decree that when the music plays, that people have to worship the image. I don't mean no harm, and I know you always hear it, but you got to be careful what kind of music you listen to. You got to be careful what you let into this head of yours, because sometimes the music will make you bow to things that you wouldn't normally bow to. That's why when certain songs say right foot stump and left foot stump, subconsciously you already start doing things. Now, it's not bad to stump your feet, but when it says call a woman out of name and you do it, when it says call a woman out of name and she answers, you got to be careful what you listen to. And so he makes this image. To me, the image represents something that was glitzy. It was big. It was glamorous. But I remember my grandmother telling me, everything that glitters ain't gold. Everything that shimmers is not shiny for you. And so the people of the Hebrew people, the Israelites, Daniel and his friends had said, I'm not going to worship this image. Now, I don't mean no harm, but sometimes when you say you're not going to do something, especially to the person that seems to be in charge, you might feel like you're getting in trouble. But can I suggest to you that I would rather be in trouble with man than in trouble with God on any day of the week? I don't know if I'm talking to anybody in here, but sometimes people will try to make you do stuff that really ain't pleasing in the eyesight of God. And so the first thing you need to notice, and I'm moving quickly because I know the time is far spent, but the first thing you need to notice about the Hebrew boys is that they were different. One of the biggest things that you have to learn in your college life, in your life as an adult, in your life as a parent, as an administrator, as a teacher, as a faculty or staff member is you have to be different. Even when you go for a job interview, nobody wants to hire somebody that looks like everybody else. And so the Hebrew boys were really different. They didn't do what everybody else did. They didn't say what everybody else says. If you was to go back in Daniel chapter 1, you would find out that they wouldn't even eat the meat that the king was eating, because they understood that whoever feeds you controls you. So understand that you have to be different. You may have to make unpopular decisions. You may have to let some people go. You may have to let some things go. And some of the people in your life, they're really not going to be supportive of that change. So one of the things that I know I learned to avoid is even in sociology was that change always brings conflict. Anytime you do something different, you have to realize that these Hebrew boys were not from Babylon. And so not only did they have to be different, but they had to deal with some distractions. Some of you dealt with personal distractions. Some of you barely made it here because there were some distractions in your life that wanted to keep you from your destiny. I can remember when I first got the Voorhees some years ago. And I was in the dorm, and I was only here for about 1 or 2 months. My mom called me. She said, "Your father has passed away." My first semester, you know, I really almost didn't make it to college. But now I'm getting a distracting phone call from my study saying, "Your father is gone." And so now I had to make a decision. Well, the truth of the matter is I went home and buried him, but if I sit there with him in the grave, then I still can't get to my destiny. It's some dead stuff that you really can't hold on to. It's some dead stuff that you really got to leave alone. If you really want to make it to what God has for you, if you really want to make it to another level, some dead stuff you got to leave in the grave. And so you can't get caught up on distractions. The first thing that happened is the people of the town were running back telling the king that these boys wasn't bowing. You know how your haters do. Go back and tell everything you do. They're so critical about you. They're so controlling about you. They want everybody to know that you ain't who God said you was. But I came here to tell somebody that you don't have an identity crisis. God said that you're blessed, so you're blessed. God said that you're healed, so you're healed. God said that you're intelligent, so you're intelligent. And sometimes this comes in the form of family and friends. Sometimes the distraction is even yourself. And so in this story, the distraction was the threat of fire. Because the king knew that if I tell them that I'm about to make this fire 7 times hotter, then I know they're about in. And that's what some of your enemies are doing in your life. They'll try to make the situation just a little bit harder. Because he feels like if I can make it harder, he'll go back to smoking weed. If I can make it harder, he'll go back to sleeping around. If I can make it just a little bit harder, he'll go back to being an alcoholic. But I came to tell somebody on this morning, don't bow when things get hard. The truth of the matter is, you should not let pressure change your position. And there's so many people in college right now. Some people in this room are saying, "I'm going home because midterms didn't look so good. I'm going home because I just lost my girlfriend. I'm going home because I just lost my boyfriend." But don't let pressure change your position. If your position is that you're going to graduate, then graduate. If your position is that you're going to be a doctor, then be a doctor. If your position is that you're going to be a lawyer, then be a lawyer. Don't let pressure change. And so too many people are becoming distracted. But my message to you is, despite the fires in your life, you still have to remain determined. You still have to say to yourself, whatever happens, I'm going to be decisive about this matter. And one of our biggest problems is we sit on the fence too much with stuff. It's certain books that people are supposed to write, and they say, "Well, I'm going to just hold off on it." It's certain majors that you know you want to go into, and instead of you getting the tutoring, you're going to take something easier. But this is the hour where God said, reach up and grab it. Whatever it is that you want in your life, I'm giving it to you. All you got to do is give me your life, and I'll make it happen. So the Hebrew boys stayed determined. They had faith in God despite what was going on. Can I tell you something? The king was now taking them to the furnace, okay? Which means they started to feel the heat. Yeah. Some of y'all are starting to feel the heat of life. Yeah, that's why class is getting harder. That's why family situations are getting harder. Some of you financial situations are getting harder because you're starting to feel the heat and the pressures of life. They saw people dying around them. Even the people who threw them in the fire started dying around them. They started to feel the heat because the king turned up the fire, but something else was going on because even though they felt the heat, even though they saw the fire, they were not getting burnt themselves. Can I suggest to somebody in the room that because of where your dependence is, you won't be burned by the fire? Because you depend on God and trust in God, and because you're so determined to please God, the fire will burn up everybody else and everything else around you, but it will not destroy you. Y'all believe that? Yeah. You have to be determined to show your dependence to God. It's too many people that depend on money. It's too many people that depend on family members and depend on friends. And I know this is an educational institution and we got to have our books, and I agree with books, but it's too many people that depend on their own knowledge. We're in the hour where if you really want to see a move, you got to depend on God. And so everybody else moved to the king's music. I'm done. I promise. I'm wrapping up here. What time is it? Everybody depended and moved to the king's music. They depended on a lot of temporary things. But you can't depend on drugs and alcohol to do it, because that'll let you down. You can't depend on people and money to do it, because we've seen just a couple years ago, that'll let you down. But the only thing that will last in your life is God. And the thing that I love about the Hebrew boys is they trusted him from the beginning of their decision. They didn't waver. They didn't change their position because they were challenged with pressure. Can I tell you our biggest problem? Our biggest problem in life is fires come, but we don't have a fire escape plan. And you don't realize it, but I really just gave you the plan. The plan is be different. The plan is don't focus on distractions. The plan is be determined. The plan is to always be dependent on God. And guess what will happen? You'll be delivered. Some of you are in some stuff right now, and you tried it your way. Some of you are in some stuff right now, and you tried it even your parents' way. And it just would not work. But I came to tell somebody this morning, if you really want to see things through, if you really want to go to another level, you have to depend on God. Alright, so I'm done. Now you're going to come out. So, why did they have to go on the fire? Play some song. You let Pastor go and pull it tonight at 6:30, so y'all make sure. They had to go to the fire because for three reasons. I promise I'll take my seat. The first reason was because in the fire, they were protected. If you look at verse 22 in Daniel chapter 3, it says that when the men who bound them and put them in the fire, those men all died around them. Some of you have enemies, and they're close to you. But God said, this fire is not to kill you, but this fire is to burn some stuff up from around you. This fire is to burn up the drug abuse that you've been having. This fire is to burn up the stress and the depression that you've been having. And so the only reason God is allowing you to go in this fire is because there's some stuff around you that needs to be burned up. But the second reason is to purify you. If anybody knows anything about gold, the way that you get pure gold is it has to go through the fire. And some of you, the only way that you're going to know who you are in God, the only way that you're going to really know your identity is that God has to take you through the fires of life. He has to direct and guide you. But then the last reason is because God wants to promote you. At the end of the story, the same king that put him in the fire, he was peeping in. Because sometimes your haters, y'all, they'll look to see if you're dead. Sometimes they'll look in and say, did he die in the fire? But what he saw was four men. Now the weird thing about that is, he only threw three men in the fire. Can I tell you that Jesus is going to meet you in the fire? Jesus met the boys in the midst of their circumstance. He met the boys in the midst of their trial. He met the boys in the midst of their hurt and pain. But what does it matter if you have hurt and pain as long as you got Jesus? Some of you are hurting on the inside. Some of you are crying out on the inside. But can I tell you that Jesus is in the fire with you? What does it matter if you're crying? As long as I got King Jesus, everything's going to be alright. Closing my Bible. Don't fall to distractions. It's by escape plan, God. Be determined. Be dependent on God. And God will always deliver. Clap your hands and give God.